And I'll chair the morning session. So the first talk in the morning session will be given by Professor Hong Yao from Tsinghua University, and he will talk about imagined space-time supersymmetry in 2D and 3D topological phases. So let's welcome the speaker.
Thank you for the introduction. And I also would like to thank the organizers, especially Dawei and Bingo, for inviting me to this wonderful place, Tsinghua University, here. As Bozong just mentioned, I'm from Tsinghua University, actually in Beijing. Actually, these two Tsinghua University are due to each other. If you look at long time scale, they actually flow to the same fixed point. All right. So today I will discuss about emergent space-time supersymmetry in 2D and 3D topological phases. Before I go into the content of this talk, I would like to thank the collaborators for the works discussed in this talk. They are Sao Peijian, Yifan Jiang, and Zixiang Li. They are my students at Tsinghua University in Beijing. I also would like to thank Joseph and Chen Hong from University of Alberta. As we all know, symmetry play a really important role in defining and characterizing basal matter, both condensed matter and cold atom systems. For conventional or set of matter, they have broken symmetries. For instance, ferromagnetic break, spin rotational symmetry, and tiny Bosel symmetry. Superfluid and superconduct break gauge symmetry, or particle number conservation symmetry. So these are conventional state of matter with broken symmetries, characterized by broken symmetries. There are also interesting phases or exotic phases with preserving symmetry, namely the symmetry of the ground state are the same as the symmetry of the Microsoft models. There are many interesting examples of such phases. For instance, long-range entangled topological phases such as fractional quantum Hall state and quantum spin liquid. All these phases, they do not have broken symmetries but has fractionalized excitation and fractional statistics with topological order. There are also, more recently, a phase matter called symmetry protect topological phases such as topological integrators and Houdin spin wall chain. They do not have intrinsic topological order, but they have gapless boundary state which are protected by the symmetry on the question. Today I will focus on another aspect of symmetry, phases with emergent symmetry. Namely, the symmetry in the ground state or the low energy and long distance are larger than the symmetry in the Microsoft models. Such emergent symmetry usually occur at critical points or critical phases where the length scale diverge, so that we can look at the long distance behavior of such systems to look for emergent symmetries or enlarged symmetries. There are already examples of emergent symmetries. Many of you know emergent Lorentz symmetry in a material such as graphene. Graphene is described by 2D Dirac fermions. 2D Dirac fermions has emergent Lorentz symmetry, even though the graphene, the lattice, or the system itself doesn't have Lorentz symmetry. It's not a continuous rotational environment, but at low energy, when the chemical potential is exactly at the direct point, the system has emergent Lorentz symmetry. The other example of emergent Lorentz symmetry is 3D direct fermions in this material and some other materials. More recently, there are three dimensional wire semi-metal discovered in this family of materials. So this also realized emergent Lorentz symmetry in three dimensions. So there are more exotic emergent symmetries, so-called emergent gauge symmetry. Such emergent gauge symmetry can occur in quantum spin liquid with emergent SU2 gauge field, emergent U1 gauge field, emergent Z2 gauge field. Today I will focus on this question. Can a space-time supersymmetry emerge in condensed matter or cold atom systems? Here's the outline of this talk. I will give you a brief introduction to the concept of space-time supersymmetry, or called SUSY. After that, I will discuss emerging supersymmetry or emerging SUSY at the superconducting transition point in three-dimensional wires and metal. This study is from the realization group analysis. After that, I will discuss emerging supersymmetric gauge theory on the surface of a correlated topological instrument such as SMB6. This is also from the realization group analysis. After that, if I still have time, I would like to discuss emerging supersymmetry at the edge of quantum critical point of a 2D topological superconductors. And this is from a sign problem free quantum Monte Carlo study. It's more related to the subject of this conference. In the end, I will summarize. Now let me give a brief introduction to space-time SUSY. What is a SUSY or supersymmetry? As we know, usual symmetries are bosonic symmetry, such as spin rotational symmetry, translation symmetry. All these symmetries are bosonic symmetry, in the sense that all these symmetry generators are bosonic operators. For such symmetry transformation, a particle with fermionic species still transform to fermions. Bosons still transformed to bosons. The statistics of the particle doesn't change under usual bosonic symmetry, such as spin rotational symmetry, translation symmetry. But supersymmetry is a fermionic symmetry. Namely, the symmetry object of supersymmetry is fermionic. The statistics of the particle changes under supersymmetry transformation. A fermion is transformed to boson or vice versa under supersymmetric transformation. Okay, so this symmetry is a fermionic symmetry. It changes the statistic or spin of a particle. So in a supersymmetric theory, each particle has a corresponding superparticle. For instance, in a supersymmetric theory, electron has a corresponding superparticle called S electron or super electron. Electron is a fermion, but S electron is a boson. Quark has a corresponding superparticle called S quark. S quark is also a boson. Photon is a boson. Its superparticle is called a photino. It's a fermion. Okay. So in a supersymmetric theory, each particle has a corresponding superparticle. They differ by their statistics, greater statistics. This is a more mathematical definition of a supersymmetry, space-time supersymmetry. So we have a supersymmetric generator Q alpha. These Q alpha are fermionic operators. They satisfy this anti-commutation relation. Because of these Q fermionic operators, when a system has this kind of symmetry, this theory is called a supersymmetric. So this P is the energy momentum vector. Okay, basically, supersymmetry, so this is like a square, Q square. Supersymmetry is a square root of a space-time symmetry. Okay. So I'd like to mention that space-time supersymmetry is very different, is different from the quantum mechanical supersymmetry. For quantum mechanical supersymmetry, this supersymmetric transformation only along the time direction. Okay. So this the Hamiltonian of supersymmetric quantum mechanical theory has this kind of form. So it has supersymmetry along the time direction. But for space-time supersymmetry, it has a supersymmetric transformation along all time and spatial directions. So I could mention some hallmarks of a supersymmetric theory. First is Lorentz invariant. Second, the number of fermionic modes or fermionic particles is the same of the number of bosonic particles because each particle has a corresponding superparticle. Moreover, the bosons and the fermions have identical mass and other quantum numbers except the statistics. So S electron and the electron, they have identical mass in a supersymmetric theory, except that they and other internal quantum numbers except the spin. Okay. Why is SUSY interesting and important? SUSY was introduced more than 40 years ago to go beyond a standard model and to solve many mysterious issues in particle physics. For instance, SUSY was conceived as a promising theory to solve hierarchy problem. There's one question in particle physics, why the Higgs boson mass is so small? Why this particle is so light? Why this particle is locked in the Planck energy scale? And SUSY can provide an answer to such questions. Another motivation to introduce SUSY is grand unification. But evidence of SUSY in particle physics is still lacking. The first round LHC experiment is negative in finding evidence of a superparticle. So they are trying to look for a supersymmetric particle, a superparticle in a second round. Maybe in the future collider, possible collider, the so-called Great Collider in China. It was proposed by many particle physicists, but it's still under debate. One of the purpose of proposing a Great Collider is to look for a superparticle or evidence of a supersymmetry at higher energy. So the current universe certainly a Great supersymmetry. Electron around us, there is no S electron. So supersymmetry is evidently broken. But the question is whether supersymmetry in high energy, whether supersymmetry can be respected at higher energy, like T3. But for our condensed matter physicists or working on cold atom systems, so we ask, can supersymmetry emerge in quantum many body systems at low energy and long distance, even though the microscopic systems of quantum many body systems are not supersymmetric. So yes, emergent space-time SUSY was first studied in one-dimensional condensed matter systems. The first example is tricritical pod in one-dimensional dilute IC model, the IC model with vacancy. So this was first proposed by these authors in 80s. There are also other development to proposing emergent space-time SUSY in one-dimensional systems in these papers. More recently, emergent SUSY was proposed in two-dimensional systems. Here, I'd like to mention this remarkable proposal by these three authors, Tyrone Glover, Donna Chen, and Ashwin Vishwanath. So in 2004, they proposed that emergent SUSY may occur on the surface of a helium-3D when the system undergo a spontaneous tiny boson symmetry break. Okay, the helium-3B has a Majorana, single Majorana cone on the surface. Okay, this gapless Majorana fermion is protected by tiny boson symmetry on the surface of helium-3B. Helium-3B is a topological superconductor, or topological superfluid. They propose that if the system can undergo some spontaneous kind of boson symmetry by tuning some parameter, okay? And then when the tiny boson symmetry is broken, this Majorana fermion is gapped because the gapness of Majorana fermion is protected by tiny boson. When tiny boson is broken, the fermion is gapped, Majorana fermion is gapped. And then they analyze the quantum critical behavior of this spontaneous tiny boson symmetry. They found that this IC order parameter or tiny boson symmetry breaking order parameter, the fluctuation of the IC order parameter is a super partner of this Majorana fermion. So, okay. So this is a very remarkable proposal on the surface of a topological superconductors. So now I would like to ask this question. Can SUSY, so all these previous proposals, including this one, they realize SUSY in either two-dimensional system or one-dimensional system. So I would like to ask this question. Can emergent SUSY occur in the bulk of a three-dimensional system? So last year we showed that SUSY can emerge at the superconducting transition in the bulk of a three-dimensional wire assembly. So I will discuss this, this in more detail later. The second question I would like to ask, can SUSY with gauge field, such as supersymmetric QED, emerge in condensed matter systems? Well, recently we showed that supersymmetric QED can emerge on the surface of a topological instrument such as SMD6. This is a candidate of topological tunnel instrument. In the end, I would like to answer these questions. So all these previous studies are from the renormalization group calculations, including this one. And we'd like to ask, can evidence of emergent supersymmetry be observed in unbiased and numerical exact simulations? And we studied the emergent supersymmetry by the sign problem free Majorana quantum Monte Carlo simulations. So now let me look at discuss the first aspect. A 3D wire semi-metal has a wire point. A wire point in a wire semi-metal is a touching point between two band, non-degenerate band. And the dispersion around this touching point is linear. The low energy physics of a wire semi-metal can be described by this wire equation or wire Hamiltonian. In order to realize a wire point, either a time reversal or emergent symmetry has to be broken. And this wire point acts as a magnetic monopole in momentum space. Namely, if we look at the Bailey curvature along the wire point, it's like the magnetic monopole in momentum space. Since Fermion has this doubling theorem in a lattice model, in a three-dimensional system, there are at least two wire points. Okay, this is due to the Fermion doubling theorem. And wire Fermion are protected by a translation symmetry and a particle number conservation symmetry. Namely, if the system breaks either translation symmetry or particle number conservation symmetry, the wire Fermion can be gathered. So how can SUSY emerge in a three-dimensional wire semi-metal? So we consider a wire semi-metal with only two wire points. So this is the simplest wire point we can realize in a three-dimensional lattice system. Okay. Suppose the wire momentum has plus k, has momentum plus k and minus k. So we have two low-energy wire fermions called psi plus k, psi minus k. To be possible, are supersymmetric. The low-energy theory should also have two complex bosons. As I mentioned earlier, each particle should have a corresponding superparticle in a supersymmetric theory. So in order to realize two complex bosons, so we need to consider a symmetry breaking phase, which breaks both translation symmetry and gauge symmetries. Okay. So here, the wire semi-metal or wire part is protected by gauge symmetry and translation symmetry. And this, both of these symmetries are U1 symmetry. Gauge symmetry is a U1 symmetry. Translation symmetry with incommensurate momentum is also a U1 symmetry. So now if we realize a phase break both gauge symmetry and translation symmetry, we can realize two U1 order parameters. A Piotrowski wave is a natural candidate of a broken symmetry phase with such two such U1 order parameters. So let me explain what is the Piotrowski wave. Normally, superconductivity in a system can be described by this quantity, okay, a fermion or an electron pair at R pair with another electron at R prime. And we use this to describe this pair condensate, this condensate. This quantity has the internal form factor dependence, this relative coordinate dependence. Okay, and also the center mass momentum, center mass dependence. So this F usually like S wave, P wave, E wave is an internal form factor dependence. For a normal superconductor, this delta, the center mass dependence is trivial, it's a constant. But for a pair density wave, the pair has finite momentum, namely this center mass is not a constant. It has modulation with momentum Q, okay, some characteristic momentum Q. For a pair density wave, the modulation have both momentum Q and minus Q, such that this pair is still kind of also involved. Okay, so now we have a U1 order parameter at momentum plus Q and a U1 order parameter as momentum minus Q. So you can consider this pair density wave as two superconducting condensate, one at momentum plus Q, the other at momentum minus Q. And the system is kind of also involved. Formerly, this phase of matter was called FFLO. Now it has a new name called pair density wave. So such pair density wave is good for realizing, possible to realizing smoothing. Since we have two wire fermions, we also have two U1 bosons. And then we ask, can this pair density wave transition occur in a three-dimensional wire system matter? And if such a transition occur, can smoothing emerge at the transition? So we can write down some microscope model describing a wire system metal with two wire pump at momentum plus K and minus K. This momentum, in general, are incommensurate. And then these low energy physics of this wire system metal can be described by this non-intact harmonic. Okay, it has two wire pump. The toy describes the valley in this system. And then we consider interactions in the system to ask whether pair density wave occur in such a system. The interaction we consider is the simplest interaction, the on-site Hubble U. Okay, just attractive interaction, since we would like to have superconductivity. So we consider an on-site attractive interaction in this wire system metal. And then we perform mean field calculation to study the quantum phase dipole. It turned out that only pair density wave can fully gap out the wire pump. So I won't go into the details of this the argument of why a uniform pair doesn't gap out the nodes. So normally uniform pair can gap out the node, but because of this the magnetic monopole around the wire pump, this plus and minus, the uniform pair cannot gap out the node. Only pair density wave can gap out the node. So from the mean field calculation, we found that when the interaction is strong enough, the attractive interaction is strong enough, the wire system metal can go through a phase transition into a pair density. And from the mean field calculation, the transition is continuous. So now we have a continuous pair density wave transition. The next question is, can SUSY emerge at this quantum critical? So this is the picture of this problem. So we have two wire pump, and the pair density wave have two condensate, one at momentum plus Q, the other at momentum minus Q. And we want we would like to ask whether SUSY can emerge at the transition. So we do RG analysis to see the quantum critical behavior at the quantum at the transition. So this is a low energy action at the pair density wave. So I probably won't go into the details. The low energy theory of this pair density wave transition can be described by this action, which has this fermionic part and also the bosonic part. And SI describes the interaction between the bosons and the fermions. This is the usual Yukawa coupling. between boson fermions. So in this theory, the wire fermion has a Fermi velocity. Okay, it's called Vf. In general, it's anisotropic. The bosons also has a boson velocity. It's called Vp. Okay, and this theory is not supersymmetric at all, since first the theory has two velocity. When a theory has two velocity, it means it's not Lorentz invariant. So with Lorentz invariant, there's only one speed of light. So this microscope theory certainly is not supersymmetric. Moreover, these interactions are independent, this U and U plus minus and G. And the theory is not supersymmetric. But the question is whether this theory can be supersymmetric at low energy and long distance. Namely, whether under the generalization group flow, the velocity of the fermions and the bosons can flow to the same velocity or not at low energy. Okay. And so we do edge analysis to study the flow of the velocity as well as the coupling constant by the dimensional relativity. Since we studied the system in 3 plus 1 dimension, eventually we said epsilon equal to 0. So we are at the 4 energy. So this is the flow equation of the velocities and the coupling constants. So this is some detail which I won't go into. So this is a flow diagram. Indeed, the velocity of the bosons and the fermions, they flow to the same value. The ratio between the boson and the fermion velocity, they flow to 1. Namely, eventually the speed of light emerges at the fixed point. Moreover, the coupling constant, the interaction coupling constant, they all flow to 0 in some special case, special threshold. So the fixed form G, U, and U plus minus, they all flow to 0. So the fixed point action at the quantum critical point is very simple. It is described by two fermions, okay, as well as two bosons. They have the same velocity. Okay. This fixed point action respect this supersymmetric transformation. So we realize a special kind of n equal to 2 supersymmetry in 3 plus 1 dimension. So this is the first example, theoretical example of space-time supersymmetry in a 3 dimensional many body system. Here I would like to discuss a little bit about the possible experimental realization of SUSY in solid state material. As I mentioned at the beginning, wire semi-metal was discovered in this family of material, but there are 24 wire pumps. Not two wire form. This is not good for realizing SUSY because we would like to have a wire semi-metal with two wire form. More recently, we proposed a wire semi-metal in mercury carbide, strain mercury carbide, and also this carbide. But this family of material can only realize 8 wire form. So far, there is no wire form with only two wire point realized in solid state systems. Fortunately, there's various proposals of realizing a wire semi-metal with two wire point in cold atom systems. Various proposals is very promised. Moreover, the interaction in cold atom system has a very good fungibility. Namely, attractive U interaction, strong attractive U interaction in cold atom system may be realized in fresh bottom resonance. So this cold atom system seems have a promising role to possibly realizing emerging super symmetry. So how much time? Okay. So now let me briefly discuss the second question I asked. Can SUSY with gauge field such as supersymmetric QED emerge in condensed matter systems? So we propose to realize this supersymmetric QED in on the surface of a topological integrators with three directions. Since in order to have three directions, so we cannot directly consider a two-dimensional system. It's an odd number of directions. So we need to consider a surface of a topological integrator. There's one material, SMB6. So the 111 surface of SMB6 is like this, has a hexagonal Brillouin zone. It has three direct fermions on the 111 surface of this material. There are also other candidate material to realize three surface direct fermions. So now, to be possibly supersymmetric, the philosophy is similar. So we would like to have three bosons. So since we have three fermions at low energy, so we'd like to have three bosons, and then ask whether a supersymmetry emerges at some quantum critical point. So we can consider intra-valley Kelvin or inter-valley Kelvin. So we have three valleys on this hexagonal Brillouin zone. So we can pair fermions with itself, or pair fermions, pair one with two, or two with three, and three with one. Okay. And the second type of Kelvin is called inter-valley Kelvin. So this inter-valley Kelvin, the condensate has finite momentum. It's a finite momentum Kelvin. This intra-valley Kelvin is a zero momentum Kelvin because the momentum at the valley is already high. So if we consider the condensate, the momentum is twice of this momentum. It's equivalent to zero. So it's a zero momentum Kelvin. But the inter-valley Kelvin has a finite momentum. So it's called, again, Kelvin density. So now I'd like to discuss the symmetries of the problem or the 111 surface of SMB6. So the system certainly has U1 symmetry, the particle normal concentration, because it's a surface of a insulator. So it has a U1 symmetry. Moreover, it has translation symmetry. So the U1 symmetry can be broken by a Kelvin density weight. And translation symmetry can also be broken by a Kelvin symmetry. There's another symmetry in this system, the C3 rotational symmetry. Okay. If you look at the Brillouin zone, it has 120-degree rotational symmetry, C3 rotational symmetry. Bimeticity can break this symmetry. Okay. If the system has some preferred direction, which can break the C3 rotational symmetry. So we have two kinds of Kelvin density weight. One is the isotropic Kelvin density weight, namely the condensate, these three condensates have identical value in the broken symmetry phase. The other is mimetic Kelvin density weight. Only one of the condensate is non-zero. The other two are zero in the broken symmetry phase. And this is actually good. The mimetic Kelvin density wave is good because it breaks all these three symmetries. Since we would like to have three bosons, so we would like to break all these three symmetries. C3 rotational symmetry at low energy is like the U1 symmetry. Okay. So now, for this mimetic Kelvin density wave, there is no C3 symmetry. It breaks the U1 break translation. So this is good in the sense of realizing possible supersymmetric theory. So we consider this mimetic transition. So this is a low energy effective theory describing the mimetic Kelvin square transition. So this describes the three fermions. This describes the bosons. The boson action is like the usual Ginsburg number of free energy. And these bosons interact with each other at the particle level. Okay. And this is, again, this Yukawa coupling. And then we do the RG analysis. So this is the result we get. So we obtain this stable fixed point. Again, this the fermion velocity and boson velocity, they flow to the same value. Moreover, the interaction strengths now, they do not flow to zero. They are still finite, but with this special relation, U is equal to G squared. When this relation is satisfied and this theory is supersymmetric, namely, it's irrelevant under this supersymmetric transformation. So we realize a supersymmetric XYZ model. The fixed point action is called a supersymmetric XYZ model. It has three direct polynomials with three complex bosons. They are supercardinal of each other. So the picture is this. So we have a surface direct polynomials of three direct points. Under a Lie-Magic Piel-Lenski wave transition, at the tricritical point, the theory is supersymmetric. And this theory is the supersymmetric XYZ theory. Okay. Moreover, this mirror symmetry can transform this supersymmetric XY theory into a supersymmetric QED. Namely, these two theories are due to each other. A supersymmetric XYZ are due to a supersymmetric QED in 2 plus 1 dimension. This duality is the usual version, supersymmetric version of particle vortex duality in 2 plus 1. So in other words, supersymmetric QED emerged at the tricritical Lie-Magic Piel-Lenski wave transition on the surface of a topological constraint with three direct cones. So this is the first theoretical example of emergent supersymmetric case. So now let me briefly discuss the numerical simulation of emergent supersymmetry in a two-dimensional topological supercanal. Again, in this paper, I mentioned earlier, they proposed to realize emergent supersymmetry on a surface of a three-dimensional topological supernatural. They also have a proposal to realize supersymmetry on the edge of a two-dimensional topological supernatural. Okay. Again, when the tiny water symmetry is spontaneously broken, at the quantum critical point, supersymmetry emerges. But we would like to study this emergent supersymmetry from a numerical exact simulation. So we consider a two-dimensional topological superconductor, this P plus IP Piel-Lin for spin-up electrons and P minus IP Piel-Lin for spin-down electrons. Okay, the H has a helical Majorana mode. These helical Majorana modes are protected by a tiny Bosel symmetry. And then we consider an interaction in this system. So we have a topological supercanal at the first time, and then consider interaction to study the interaction effect in a topological supercanal. So this interaction is on-site Hubble interaction. There are 2 possible quantum phase diagrams of a system with H. So if we consider a system with H, these are 2 possible of phase diagram as a function of U. The first scenario is that the system can go through a direct transition from the topological superconductor to a trivial superconductor. And this transition breaks tiny Bosel symmetry both at in the bulk and at the boundary at the same time. The second scenario is that the tiny Bosel symmetry is first broken on the edge. So in this intermediate range, the bulk is still tiny Bosel environment. Only H breaks tiny Bosel symmetry. At a larger interaction, the bulk breaks tiny Bosel symmetry. Okay. These are 2 possible scenarios for a system with gapless H. So we studied this microscopic model by a quantum Monte Carlo simulation using the recently proposed Majorana representation. So if the system, if the model have some Hubble Stanovich transformation in the Majorana basis such that the Majorana can form tiny Bosel pairs so that the sign problem can be avoided or solved in this majority contention. So we use this kind of algorithm to study these microscopic models. So this kind of algorithm is actually good for a system which doesn't have particle number concentration. So this is, it's natural to use the Majorana basis to study such microscopic models. Okay, so this is the phase diagram we obtained by the quantum Monte Carlo simulation. Indeed, we found that there's an intermediate range as a function of u. So in this range, only the edge or boundary of the system break kind of oscillation. The bulk is still kind of oscillation. Namely, we realize an edge quantum critical point. So the quantum criticality only occurs at the boundary of the system, not in the bulk. At a larger interaction, the quantum critical behavior occurs in the bulk. Eventually, the whole system break kind of oscillation. And then we look at the critical behavior at the edge quantum critical point. Since it was proposed in this paper that at the edge quantum critical point, supersymmetry might emerge. So we'd like to verify such proposal, theoretical proposal, by the numerically exact calculation. So we can calculate this critical exponent at the quantum critical point, H quantum critical point. So this is the result of this critical exponent from finite size scale. Okay. For instance, this allowance dimension of the order primate is 0.42. Which is very close to the theoretical prediction of a supersymmetric theory, which is this prediction, a Suzy prediction of this allowance dimension is exact, it's 0.4. So our numerical result is very close to the theoretical prediction. Moreover, this correlation length of frequency is also quite close to the theory, to the Suzy prediction. So we think that this critical exponent are strong evidence of emergent supersymmetry at the edge quantum critical point. Okay. Another hallmark of emergent supersymmetry is the internal quantum number between the fermion and boson, between a particle and a superparticle. So if the theory is supersymmetric, the fermion and boson, they should have identical masses. So we can calculate the masses of the fermions on the edge by quantum Monte Carlo simulation. So at the quantum critical point, or in the topological phases, this Majorana fermion is gapless because it's protected by Carnival. So when Carnival is broken, this fermion is gapped, divided by a mass. From the numerical calculation, we found that the fermion mass is actually identical to the mass of bosons. So this is the hallmark of emergent supersymmetry. As far as we know, it's the first time numerically to identify dynamically generated mass, equal dynamically generated mass between fermion and boson. So I have discussed the various aspects of supersymmetry. Why should we care about emergent supersymmetry in quantum made body systems? Supersymmetry is a large symmetry. It can predict many quantities exactly. This is a very, it has a high analytical control, which is usually desired in strongly correlated systems. Because of the supersymmetry, we can calculate the scaling dimension of these fermions and bosons exactly. So this is the scaling dimension of these three series I just discussed. Moreover, we can calculate the density state as a function of range, the exponent of the density state exactly. For instance, for emergent supersymmetry on the 2D surface of a three-dimensional topological instrument, usually the Dirac formula has density state, which is proportional to energy. However, here, because of supersymmetry, even though the theory is still intact, so we can get the critical exponent exactly, which is 5 quarters. And this density state can be measured in STM experiments. Moreover, we can calculate the optical conductivity also exactly, because of the emergent supersymmetry. This can also be tested by experiments. All right, with that, let me conclude. I discussed emergent supersymmetry in both in three-dimensional wire semi-metal and surface of topological superconductor by the normalization group calculation. I also discussed the numerical evidence of emergent supersymmetry on the edge of two-dimensional topological superconductors. And hopefully, such emergent supersymmetry will be realized in the future. With that, let me thank you for that.
Question. So you can just push the green button for the speaker.
Yeah. For the first two examples, do you require the chemical potential to be exactly zero?
For the first two. Yeah.
And so for condensed matter, I think that is quite tough, right? I mean, so for cold atoms, I think you might try to arrange them. But
you mean the interaction?
No, the chemical potential has to be exactly zero.
Yeah.
So what happens if you think it's when it's slightly broken?
When it's slightly away from the quantum critical point, the Suzy is not exact, but there's some trace left from the supersymmetric zero. So as you know, chemical potential is a relevant perturbation.
I think didn't get the intuition why in both cases when you do these algae and so forth it flow to that supersymmetric point. I mean, can you give us a physical picture why it wants to do that?
Yeah, this is a very good question. I actually didn't discuss. So in the first example, so with this the Kardansky wave and. So we only consider two-wire point. So if we consider four-wire point, we don't have emergent supersymmetry, even after the Kardansky wave transition. The reason is that the system only has two U1 symmetries, this gauge symmetry and translation symmetries. So for a broken symmetry phase, which only break these two symmetries, and then these two U1 parameters, they actually didn't couple at low energy. So this is a crucial point. If I consider a theory with four wire point instead of two wire point, and then there will be a Josephson coupling between these condensates such that it's like the Laguerre mode. The Laguerre mode is relevant at the critical point. Okay. So usually when the system, so when something is gapless, or we need some symmetry protection. So the other example, this 2D surface example, has similar intuition. So we need a theory, we need a broken symmetry phase which break three symmetries. So if we have this isotropic Kardansky wave, which is not good. So we need a theory which breaks the number of U1 symmetries, which is identical to the number of fermions relevant in this system. Not less, not more. Yeah, this is some dedicated requirement for emerging systems.
Okay. for a two-well Fermi assistant, can we substitute the...
Sorry, which system?
Two-well Fermi assistant, can we substitute the coefficient of charge density wave and conventional pairing for the air density wave?
Yeah, it has CDW.
I mean for the coefficient of charge density and conventional pairing, can we see the supersymmetry?
So this is a good question. So for a system with conventional pairing and the CDW, the pair density wave will be generated.
Okay.
Yeah, from the symmetry algorithm. Okay. Because the here actually it has
different order parameter for the field theory instead of pair density wave order parameter.
Yes. So here for the pair density wave with momentum q, it automatically generates a CDW with momentum 2q. So the pair density wave break translation symmetry, it is also reflected in the particle hole channel. But in the theory you mentioned with a uniform pairing and CDW, actually it's not good. Yeah, because that will couple these two wire bundles in the particle-particle channel.
Yes. Yeah. I'm just curious for the renormalization group analysis.
Yes.
If we include a gauge fluctuation.
Yeah, that's a
good. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good point. We didn't consider gauge field in this theory, because to realize a supersymmetric gauge theory, so we need gauginals. Actually, it's really hard to realize gauginals in a condensed matter system. So in the second example, I claimed that we realize emergent QED. Actually, this emergent QED is not directly emergent QED. It's a dual theory. So what we realized is actually the supersymmetric XYZ. Okay, because supersymmetric XYZ is due to a supersymmetric QED by particle vortex duality. In that sense, we realized the emergent supersymmetric gauge theory. But we really don't have direct example. It would be nice to have such a thing.
So, yes?
So I'm wondering how do you get a mass in your description for the Susi bosonic and fermionic case?
The mass?
Yeah.
Yeah, so yeah, there's another point I didn't go into detail. So in the theory we discussed, actually Susi emerged at the quantum critical point. So at the quantum critical point, it's massless. Both fermion and bosonic are massless. And then we slightly go into the broken symmetry phase. And then the boson and the fermion are massive. So strictly speaking, in the broken symmetry phase, away from the quantum critical point, the mass of fermion and boson are not identical, are not strictly identical. Okay, but as long as the system is close to this supersymmetric quantum critical point, the mass, so actually this fermion mass and boson mass has some scaling. The scaling is the same. So this the mass of the fermion is generated by the tiny Mosel symmetry break order parameter. Did I answer your
question? Okay, so if not, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.